Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Allahu alimna ma yanfa'na wa anfa'na bima alamtana. Tayyib, where are we, brothers? Which page are we on pertaining to your notes? Page 8. Page 8 and the first sentence on top of that page. The Imam, the author, Sharafuddin al-Hajjawi, he says, وَلَقْنُهَا وَكُلُّ أَجْزَائِهَا نَجِسًا. And pertaining to the dead animal, the one which died by itself, or was not slaughtered properly, Jazakallahu khair, or was not slaughtered properly, then this, the Imam is saying that its milk is impure, and all of its body parts. Because in Surah Al-An'am, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, after mentioning, كُلَّ أَجِدُ فِي مَاوِهِ يَعْنِ لَيَّ مُحَرَّمًا أَلَى طَعَامٍ يَطْعَمُهُ إِلَّا إِنْ يَكُونَ مَيْتًا أَوْ دَمًا مَسْفُوحًا أَوْ لَحْمَ خِنْزِيرٍ فَإِنَّهُ رِجْسٌ. So Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions that the dead animal or the flowing blood or the meat of the swine is impure, right? So if it's impure, then that means everything contained within it will be impure also. So this is what the Imam is referring to, right? That its milk is going to be impure. Why? Because it's contained as a liquid inside an impure vessel, which is the dead animal. Wada? Clear? Ibn Taymiyyah, he says that there's proof from the companions of Allah that they ate cheese which was made from the animals of the mushrikeen. So this is the second opinion in the matter. Right? They ate cheese from animals which was made from the mushrikeen. And the rule is, if that something is narrated from the companions of Allah anhum, and there's no mukhalifah found amongst them, there's no opposition to that opinion amongst them, then this is taken as something which is valid. So this is the second opinion by Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala. غَيْرَ شَعْرٍ وَنَحْمِهِ. The Imam, he says, other than its hair and that which is similar to it. So the dead animal is impure. Its milk and all of its body parts are impure. And the exception the Imam is giving now is other than hair and that which is similar to it. What's similar to hair? Feathers, these kind of things, right? They say the illah here, the ta'lil, the reason is because there's no ihsas. There's no feeling in this body part, right? So it's there not due to a life of its own, it's there due to the life of that which it's connected to. It, in of itself, when the animal dies, the hair reality wasn't living. Its life was connected to the fact that it was attached to the animal. And they said that it has no ihsas, so therefore it doesn't become impure. And they attach to this, وَنَحْوِهِ, the Imam, he says, and that which is like it, meaning the horns and the nails of the animal are also pure. If the animal died, or if the animal is impure due to death. So the hair, the fur, the feathers, the nails, and the horns, all of this is considered to be pure. طيب? Because there's no ihsas. The Imam says, وَمَا أُبِينَا مِنْ حَيٍّ فَهُوَ كَمَيْتَتِهِ. That which is taken from a live animal, whilst it's alive, of course, then the ruling is that of how the animal would be if it was mayta. What's mayta, we said? Mayta is the animal that died of itself, okay, due to stumbling over something of that nature, or it wasn't slaughtered properly. This is mayta. So the Imam is saying that that which is taken from the animal whilst it's alive, cut off from the animal whilst it's alive, then it's given the ruling of how it would be if it was dead, the mayta. So we know that the mayta of these animals is impure, therefore that which is taken is impure. In Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, the Prophet said in the hadith of in the hadith of Abi Waqid al-Layth, Al-Waqid al-Layth, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma qutiya min al-bahimati wa hiya hayy, fahiya mayta." Ma qutiya min al-bahimati wa hiya hayy, fahiya mayta. That which is taken from the animal whilst it's alive is treated as a mayta. It's treated as a dead animal. Okay. So if you were to cut the leg of a lamb, whilst it's living, whilst the ruling of the lamb, the part of the leg, is going to be treated as being impure. Now there's some exceptions to this. The exceptions to this are, first and foremost, that of the human being. That which is taken from the human being whilst he's alive or she's alive is considered as pure. The second of these exceptions is fish. That which is cut from a fish whilst it's alive is considered as being pure. The third of them is locust. Locust. The fourth of them is al-tarida. Al-tarida is basically when you are hunting an animal, sometimes it's difficult to get hold of the animal. So you have your axe in your hand and you throw the axe at the animal. And as the animal is running around, you cut a limb of this animal. Right? So that limb, al-tarida, which was cut, then that is considered for you to be pure. And this was done by the companions in jihad and at other times. Okay? So al-tarida is the fourth of them, which is what? That you cut the animal whilst trying to kill it, whilst it's running around. Okay, this is considered for you as being an exception also. The author now, he starts a next chapter. He starts the chapter of bab al-istinja, the chapter of istinja. Istinja in the language comes from the word naja. So the Arabs, they will say, najawtu al-shajra. Najawtu al-shajra, shajra ay qata'tuha. It has the meaning of cutting off. Okay, I cut the tree, meaning I cut the tree off, right? Technically, shar'an, istilahan, technically it means izalatul kharij min sabilayn bima'in aw hajrin aw nahwi. The removal of that which comes from the two private parts when relieving yourself, either with water or stones or something of that nature. This is the technical definition for istinja. Istinja meaning the adab that you will use after having visited the bathroom. The Imam, he says, يُسْتَحَبُّ عِنْدَ دَخُولِ الْخَلَىٰ قَوْلْ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. It's recommended that when you enter into the bathroom that you say Bismillah. Al-Khala. Al-Khala, يَخْلَىٰ, has the meaning of being hidden. So the khala, that is the place where you hide yourself to relieve yourself, okay? That's what it means by al-khala. And in the hadith in Tirmidhi, the Prophet ﷺ said, أَسَتْهُ مَا بَيْنَا أَسَتْهُ مَا بَيْنَا أَعْيُ الْجِنِ وَعَوْرَاتِ بَنِي آدَمْ إِذَا دَخْلَ أَحْدُ الْخَلَىٰ أَنْ يَقُولَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. That the barrier or the covering between the eyes of the jinn and the private parts of the sons of Adam, when they enter into the bathroom, is to say Bismillah. So when you say the Bismillah, then those genies that are in that area, they cannot see you, they are prevented from seeing you. And if you do not say it, then they will see you in Allah's and Jannah's best. When do you say the Bismillah if you are in an open space? So you've gone camping, you've walked far away from your friends, and now you're about to relieve yourself. When do you say the Bismillah? Before you put down your clothes, excellent. Before you expose your awrah, that is the time you say it, right? So here the Imam, he said that this is, what word did he use for describing this action of the basmala? What did he say? Yustahab, mustahab, okay? Recommended. The definition of recommended is that if you do it for the sake of Allah's wajal, you are rewarded. And if you leave it, there is no punishment attached to it, right? This is mustahab. Now mustahab and sunnah are generally interchangeable. In general, they are interchangeable in their usage. However, some scholars, they say there is a difference between mustahab and sunnah. Sunnah, according to these scholars, is that wherein you find a nas. Nas meaning textual evidence. If there is a nas pertaining to the issue, then you can say it's sunnah. Correct? Okay? If there's no nas, and it's taken from the qawaid al-amma, it's taken from the general rules, then we say it's mustahab. So what's recommended also after saying basmallah, the Imam says, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الْخُبْثِ وَالْخَبَائِثِ. You say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الْخُبْثِ وَالْخَبَائِثِ. This is found in the hadith in Bukhari Muslim, where Anas radiallahu anhu says, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل الخلاء قال اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الخبث والخبائث. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from the khubathi and the khaba'ith. Now this khubathi and khaba'ith, it comes in two ways. Khubathi with the sukoon. There's a sukoon on the ba. You know what sukoon is, right? The small circle. Khubathi, if it comes like this, then the meaning of khubath here is shar, is evil, any type of evil. Right? Evil in general. And khaba'ith means al-nafus al-shari'a, evil souls or evil beings, right? This is the first usage when you say khubth with the dam, with the sukoon. But now if you say it the other way, like in the hadith with the dhamma khubuthi, then khubuthi refers to the male devils and khaba'ith refers to the female devils. So you see the difference in the two usages. In the first usage with the sukoon, khubth is all types of evil, and khaba'ith is evil souls, okay? Evil creatures, whether they be human or anything else. Which one is more general? The first or the second? The first. So this, according to some of the ulama, like Sheikh Ahmed Khalil, when he explained the book, he said, هذا هو الأخر. This is better to use. Allah was blessed. طيب. The Imam, the author, he says, وَإِنَّ الْخُرُوجْ مِنْهُ غُفْرَانَكَ. And when you leave the bathroom, you say, Ghufranak, O Allah, I seek your forgiveness. Imams Ahmad and Abu Dawud, they narrate the hadith where it's narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كان إذا خرج من الخلاء قال Ghufranak, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would leave the place of relieving himself, he would say this dua, Ghufranak, O Allah, I seek your mercy. Why would you seek Allah's mercy after having been in the bathroom? That's one opinion, but there's something missing there. So the brother said, one of the opinions is that a mercy that Allah gave you to relieve yourself. But then why would you seek mercy based upon what the brother said, which is one of the opinions? No. Stick to what he's saying, but complete it. So he said that one of the reasons you seek Allah's mercy when leaving the bathroom is because it was a mercy that you relieved yourself, which is true. No. What he said. Now, because you can't thank Allah for that blessing of having been able to remove the toxins and the filth from yourself, right? You can never thank Allah for that ni'mah. That's why we say, according to that opinion, of Ufranak. Now, there's another opinion. Maybe I think you were about to touch on it. Okay, so you're not supposed to make dhikr of Allah as well, while you're in the bathroom. And therefore, you are seeking Allah's forgiveness for not having made dhikr of Allah, not having made worship of Allah, which you are supposed to do at all times. This is also an opinion. What's the reply to this opinion? You're not supposed to make dhikr in the bathroom. Who told you not to make dhikr in the bathroom? It wasn't granddad, right? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. Therefore, how can we seek forgiveness for doing something which the Prophet ﷺ told us? You see? So this opinion, put it to the side also. What's another opinion? No. So we're talking about seeking Allah's forgiveness after having relieved yourself. Another opinion that the ulama, they say that because now Allah has removed from you the physical filth, now you remember the spiritual filth, right? So as Allah has removed from you the physical filth, you remember the spiritual filth, and therefore you seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. And also you say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi adhhaba anni al-adha wa afani. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has removed from me the haram, and he has left me in a state of well-being. Okay? This is also from the sunan, which is to be said. Now many of the hadith scholars, they say that this part is inauthentic. However, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, the explainer of Sahih Bukhari, he said in the book, Natat al-Afkar, fi takhrij ahadith al-Afkar lil-Nawawi, he said that this is hasan. He said that this is, dhikr is hasan, it's authentic. As mentioned by Sheikh Mutlaq al-Jahassar. The Imam, he says, وَتَقَدِيمُ لِسْلِ الْيُسْرَى دُخُولًا وَيُمْنًا خُرُوجًا. that when you enter into the khala, which foot do you enter with? The left. And when you leave, you enter with the right. Imams of Hadith, Hakim al-Bayhaqi, they narrate from Anas radiallahu anhu, who said, من السنة, it's from the Sunnah, إذا دخلت المسجد أن تبدأ برجلك اليمنى, that you start with your right foot. وإذا خرجت أن تبدأ برجلك اليسرى, and when you leave, you start with your left foot. So the ulama, they have from this hadith and others, the principle that that which is mafdool, that which is virtuous, the right is used for it. And that which is not of virtuousness, that which is to do with cleaning oneself or to do with anything which is not in high status, then you do it with the left, right? So everything which is mafdool is with the right, and everything else which is with the left. The Imam says, وَاَعْتِمَادُهُ عَلَىٰ رِزْقِ الْيُسْرَىٰ, and the person when he's defecating, he leans towards the left. He leans towards the left. طيب. Now there's a hadith narrated by Imam al-Tabarani and al-Bayhaqi on this issue. But Imam al-Nawawi, the hadith master, the Jedi of Muhaddithin, from one of the Jedis, he said that this hadith is too weak to be used as an evidence. This hadith that is referring or is indicating that you should lean to the left when relieving yourself is too weak to be used as an evidence. However, this doesn't mean that we cannot mention what the Imam mentions, because there's ta'lil, there is reason. From the ta'lil that they give, they say that it is takriman al-yameen. That, like we said, the yameen, the right side, is used for that which is virtuous. So in order to give the right side of the body that meaning, when you're relieving yourself, you lean towards the left. Okay? Or as Sheikh Abdullah Al-Basan, he said in his explanation of Umdat Al-Ahkam, Tawdi' Al-Ahkam, Fi Sharh Umdat Al-Ahkam, he said that he's spoken to many doctors and they said that this is actually the situation. That when you lean towards the left, it's easier for you to relieve yourself. So if this is the case and it's established by doctors, or if it's found and practiced to be beneficial for a person, then you should go ahead and take that. But don't consider it to be a sunnah, because Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala said that the hadith is weak. وَبُعْدُهُ فِي فَضَائِلٍ, also from that which is recommended, or sunnah or mustahab, is that when the person wants to relieve themselves in an open space, he goes as far away as possible. Because Abu Dawood narrates from Jabir radiallahu anhu, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِلَىٰ أَرَادَ الْبَرَازِ إِنْ قَلَقَ حَتَّى لَا يُرَاهُ أَحَدٍ, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would want to relieve himself in open spaces, he would go far away to the extent that nobody could see him. طيب. What if there's something close by wherein it can cover you? Do you still have to go far away, or can you be close by? Something is close by, like there's a wall, right? You can hide behind the wall and relieve yourself. It's still better to go further away, but in this case you don't have to, because the objective is to cover yourself from the sight of the people. With regards to urinating, do they call this number two? With regards to urinating, the ulama, they say in terms of fiqh, in terms of rulings, that in this situation you don't need to go as far, okay? When you're defecating, you need to go far. But with regards to urinating, you don't need to. Why? Because these narrations, for example, the narration of Hudhayfah radiallahu anhu, who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was urinating, called him close to him as a type of a settler, a barrier between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the people, right? So they say from this, we can take that those who are urinating, they don't need to be far away from the people as long as they are covered. The Imam says, وَاسْتِتَارُهُ, and the person should have sitr, meaning that the person should have their body covered. In Sahih Muslim, Abdullah bin Ja'far, he narrates, كَانَ أَحَدُ مَسْتَتَرَ بِهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى لِحَاجَتِهِ حَدْفٌ أَوْ حَاجٌ نَخْرٌ, that from the things that the Prophet ﷺ would love to cover himself when relieving himself would be a hadfun. Hadfun is anything which has height to it, anything which is raised. Or hajj al-nakhl. Hajj al-Nakhl is a group of palm trees. So this is where the Prophet ﷺ would go to relieve himself. طيب. He would cover himself. So the Imam here is mentioning the covering under which chapter, under which recommendation. He says the mustahabbat, right? That those things which are sunnah, those things which are recommended. So it's recommended for you to cover yourself when relieving yourself. But what is he referring to here in terms of covering yourself? The recommended covering. Well, how can it be only recommended for you? Is it only recommended for you to cover yourself when you relieve yourself? It's wajib, right? It's wajib to cover your awrah. Your awrah has to be covered. That which is mustahab, okay, is that your whole body is covered. This is what he means here, right? So don't think that it's only recommended for me to cover myself from the eyes of the people. No, your awrah has to be covered, that's wajib. But what's recommended is that your body is covered, right? The Imam says, وَالْتِيَادُ بِبَوْلِهِ مَكَانًا رِخْوًا. And that the person should find soft ground when he wants to, or she wants to, urinate. Okay? Soft ground, why? What's the illah? So obviously it doesn't splash back on you. If the ground is hard, you can smash it until it becomes soft if possible. Okay? Say that, please.
We can also do it because if the ground is soft, we'll see it down.
Very good. So it won't harm the people. We'll come to that point. Very good. So the ground is soft, so like the brother said, the filth seeps into it and it doesn't harm the people. So in Bukhari Muslim, we have the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, who said, Marra al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bil qabrayn. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed by two graves. فَقَالْ إِنَّهُمَا لَا يُعَذَّبَانِ وَمَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي الْكَبِيرِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, verily these two graves are being punished. But they're not being punished in something which was big. بَلَا إِنَّهُمْ كَبِيرٌ. Rather it is big in terms of the magnitude of the punishment. أَمَّا أَحَدُهُمَا فَكَانَ يَمْشِي بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. As for one of them, the companions of this grave, he used to go around spreading gossip. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرُ فَكَانَ لَا يَسْتَتِرُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ. As for the second, he never used to protect himself from the drops of urine to come onto his clothing or into his body. ثُمَّ أَخَذَ جَرِيدَةً رَطْبَةً. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he took a dry branch. فَشَقَّهَا نِصْفَيْنِ فَغَرَزَ فِي كُلِّ قَبْرٍ وَاحِدٍ. And he broke the branch into half and he put on each grave one of them. فَقَالَ لَعَلَّهُ يُخَفِّفُ عَنْهُمَا مَا لَمْ تَيْبَسَ. Hopefully this will decrease their punishment as long as the branch doesn't become dry and fly away. طيب. So the hadith is clearly telling us the importance of protecting ourselves from urine and any other type of material. Is it a sunnah for us to do this at the burial of our dead? That you take the branch and you put it on the grave of somebody. The Prophet ﷺ did it. So how can you say it's not sunnah? You're right. Those of you who are shaking your heads very slightly, very cautiously. It's right, it's not sunnah, but how can you say that? Shaykh Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala has a nice explanation.
He said hopefully.
Of what?
He said hopefully is for
okay, that's part of it. Ahsan, jazakallah khair. It's to do with the unseen. The ghayb, we don't know the ghayb. We don't know what's taking place in the grave. Number two, we don't want to have sunnah then. We don't want to have evil opinion of the people in the grave thinking that they're being punished. You see? Jazakallah khair. The Imam says, وَمَسْحُهُ بِيَدِهِ الْيُسْرَى إِذَا فَرَغَ مِنْ بَوْلِهِ مِنْ أَصْلِ ذَكْرِهِ إِلَى رَأْسِ ثَلَاثٍ. Sorry, sometimes it's going to get a bit explicit, and this is just part of the study that we have to do. So the Sheikh, the Imam al-Hajjami, he says that from that which is recommended is that you wipe your private part, okay, after having finished urinating, from the bottom of the private part to the top of the private part. And the ulama, they say what you do here, you have the index finger and the thumb and you just wipe, okay? And the reason you do this is why? What's the reason for doing this?
Any excess
that might be there. So it all goes back to the hadith we just mentioned, okay, of the graves. that we want to avoid that punishment in the grave. So the ta'abir, the reasoning is that you do this in order to help yourself to be more clean from that. And then he says, وَنَتْهُمُ ثَلَاثًا, and you put your private part three times also. And again, this goes back to the hadith. The ta'abir, the reasoning is that you want to avoid any drops of urine splashing onto you afterwards. So you take out, you pull out whatever is left there. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he is very stern with this. He says that hadith pertaining to this are inauthentic and nothing is related pertaining to this and it shouldn't be done. He said, why? Because he said you're going to harm yourself, number one. You keep doing this to yourself daily for many times, you're going to harm yourself. Number two, it's going to play with your mind because you're going to start thinking, did I do it enough? Was it, should I have done it more? You're going to start to have waswas, right? Whispers, am I clean, am I not clean? So he says it's better to avoid it. However, Shaykh Uthaymeen agrees with the author. He said that nadr, the pulling, he said if you feel within yourself that there's a need for you to do the pulling, then go ahead and do it, there's no problem, as long as it's not done often. Imam Ibn Qudama, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that what's recommended to do also, it's very important that if you have these feelings often and these whisperings often, that did I clean myself properly or not? He said you get water after you've relieved yourself and you're making wudu, splash it on your private part and splash it on your clothes. Therefore, when shaitan comes to whisper to you that you haven't purified yourself properly, you say, no, this wetness is from the water, right? So you never say it's from the urine. You will cut off those whisperings. So the only time really that you should do it, if you truly know that by doing it, you tend to clean yourself better. The imam, he says, وَتَحَوَّلُهُ مِنْ مَوْضَعِهِ لِيَسْتَنْجِيَ إِنْ خَافَ تَلَوُّفَ, that the person, after having relieved themselves, they should move from the place that they are in, okay, before he washes himself. If conditional, if he fears that the filth will touch him, right? And this is based in the hadith narrated by Sunan al-Arba'a, where the Prophet said, لَا يَغْبُلَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي مُسْتَحَمِهِ ثُمَّ يَغْتَسِبُ فِيهِ, that none of you should urinate in the place where he is going to wash and then go ahead and shower in that place. Because then the filth will touch you, right? So the Imam is telling us that you should move from the place where you have relieved yourself before you wash yourself if you feel that najasa will touch you, will come upon you. Sunan al-Arba'a. Remember we said there's a difference. You can say Sunan al-Arba'a and Sunan al-Khamsa, right? And then Kutub al-Sitta as well. Okay, but the Sunan al-Arba'a, who do we mean by them? Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi, and Nisa'i, right? And if you say five, you add an Ahmad. If you say six, you take Ahmad off and say Bukhari Muslim. Tayyib, the author now is going to start to talk about those things which are makruh. Those things which are makruh. Makruh translated as disliked. Right? Technically, makruh is that act that if you leave it for the sake of Allah, you're rewarded. But if you do it, there's no sin upon you. If you leave it for the sake of Allah, you are rewarded. And if you do it, there's no sin upon you. However, amongst the early scholars, makruh was interchangeable many times haram. But out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they didn't find the wording used in the Quran, the hadith, for a particular issue to be haram, they wouldn't say it's haram. They would have the same status to be haram. Therefore, they would say makruh, but they would mean by that haram. But after those generations, it started to be used in the way I just described it. That if you leave it off for the sake of Allah, you are rewarded. But if you do it, there's no sin upon you. So he's going to speak about that which is makruh. He says, "Rahimahullah Taala, wa yukrahu dakhulu bi shay'in fihi dhikrullah Taala," and it's disliked for you to enter into the place al-khala, the place where you are leaving yourself, with anything that has the remembrance of Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. This is taken from the hadith narrated by al-Arba'a. Anas ibn Malik, he said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل الخلاء وضع خاتمه, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he used to enter the place to relieve himself, he would take off his ring. Why would he take off his ring? Because it would have his name on it and the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. right? إِلَّا لِحَاجَةٍ, except for a need. Meaning that you're not allowed to take something in that has the name of Allah, as we just mentioned on it, or is a remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, unless there is a need to do so. If there is a need to do so, say for example you have some money which has some dhikr of Allah on it, and you're afraid that it's going to get stolen, so they say in this situation you can take it in. Some of the ulama, they said when explaining this, if you have a Qur'an which is very special to you, you know that people who memorize the Qur'an, they like to have just one copy of the Qur'an, right? So, the imams who explained this point, the ulama, they say that if you're afraid that it's going to be stolen, you can take it in with you. But Imam al-Dawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, the author of Al-Insaf, one of the foundational books in the madhab, he said, nobody differs who has any intelligence that it's haram for you to take the book of Allah azza wa jal into the bathroom. And this is what makes sense to us most of the time. I mean, even the mere thought of somebody taking the book of Allah azza wa jal into the bathroom should give you a heart attack, right? So the opinion of the Imam al-Dawi is what we go with, inshallah. The Imam, he says, وَرَفْعُ ثَوْبِهِ قَبْلَ دُنُوِهِ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ, and to raise the person's clothing before he comes close to the earth to relieve himself. What's the ruling of this? Is it recommended? Who's with me? It's makruh, because the Imam is talking about the things which are now makruh pertaining to the bathroom mannerisms, right? And this hadith is found in Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi, where it's narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كان إذا أراد حاجة لا يرفع ثوبه حتى يدنو من الأرض. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he wanted to relieve himself, he wouldn't raise up his clothing until he was close to the ground. وكلامه في problem for many people, right? The Imam is saying it's also disliked that you speak in the bathroom. Abu Dawood radiallahu anhu, rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Abu Dawood, he narrates from Al-Muhajib ibn Qunfud. Muhajib ibn Qunfud radiallahu anhu, one time he said, I came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whilst the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was urinating. What do we understand from this now? Remember we said for sure the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was covered, right? There's no doubt in that. So there's something covering the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But his companion came to the Prophet ﷺ and gave him salam whilst the Prophet ﷺ was urinating. The Prophet ﷺ didn't reply. Until the Prophet ﷺ made wudu. Then he went to the companion, okay, Muhajir ibn Qunfud, and he apologized to him. And he explained. He said, إِنِّي كَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى عَلَى غَيْرِ طُهْرٍ. I disliked to mention Allah's name except in a state of purity. Meaning whilst I was in a state of impurity, I didn't want to mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So based upon this, they say it's not, it's disliked for you to mention the name of Allah azza wa jalla whilst in the bathroom. Tayyib. If one sneezes in the bathroom, and he knows that the sunnah is to say alhamdulillah once he sneezes, what should he do? He should get out, stop the shower. It's good then, it's true, possible, sorry for laughing, but it's, maybe. Depends who's there with you, right? He says it in his heart, right? He says it in his heart. If one hears the adhan whilst he's in the bathroom, what does he do? In his heart he complies, but once he gets out, he has to make the reply again. Tayyib ijabatan lil mu'adhdhin. To reply to the mu'adhdhin, right? إِذَا سَمِعْتُمُ الْنِدَاءَ فَقُولُوا مِثْلَ مَا يَقُولُ الْمُؤَذِّنُ. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, if you hear the call to prayer, then say what the mu'adhin is saying. So in this situation, you reply in your heart, and once you get out, you reply again verbally. وَبَغْلُهُ فِي شَرْقٍ وَنَحْرِهِ. And also disliked is that the person urinates in a hole or a crack in the ground. A hole or a crack in the ground. Why do you think? What?
There might be some ants inside.
There may be something harmful inside, right? So you're coming close to the ground, you're urinating, something harmful may come out and attack you, right? Imam Ahmad And Imam Nawawi, they narrate, and they said the hadith is authentic, that Qatada, he narrates from Abdullah ibn Sarjas radiallahu anhu, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam naha an yakula rajul fil hujr, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade that a person urinate in these holes. وَقِيلَ لِقَتَادَ مَا يَكْرَهُ الْبَوْلُ فِي الْحُجْرِ. Why is it that it's disliked to urinate in these homes, all these places? He said, إِنَّهَا مَسَاكِنَ الْجِنْ. Verily, it is the places where jinn are found. Right? So there could be jinn living there also, as a narrated by Qatada. Imam Tabarani and Al-Kabir and Imam Al-Hakim in his Al-Mustadrak, they narrate an incident where Sa'd ibn Ubadah, the chief of Al-Khazraj tribe, one of the main tribes in Medina, he was once in Asham, the lands of Asham. He urinated in some rocky area or on some stones, like on the ground. Soon after, he was found dead, soon after having done that. On the same day in Medina, it was heard from a well some poetry, where they said, نَحْنُ قَتَلْنَا سَيْدِ الْخَزْرَجِ سَعْدْ ibn Ubadah. We have killed the chief of Al-Khazraj, Sa'd ibn Ubadah. رَمَيْنَهُ بِسَحْمَيْنِ فَلَمْ تُخْطِي فُؤَادَ. We sent two arrows upon him and we didn't miss the target of his heart. Okay? So this is an authentic narration according to some scholars, backing up what the previous narration said from Qatada and Abdullah ibn Sarjas, that you shouldn't urinate in places like cracks on the ground or holes in the ground. وَمَسُّ فَرْتِهِ بِيَمِينِهِ. And also disliked is that you touch your private parts with your right hand. In Bukhari Muslim is narrated from the hadith of Abi Qatada radiallahu anhu, who said that the Prophet said, لَا يُمْسِكَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَكْرَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ وَهُ يَقُولُ وَلَا يَتَمَسَّحْ مِنَ الْخَلَاءِ بِيَمِينِهِ وَلَا يَتَنَفَّسُ بِالْإِنَاءِ. The Prophet said in this hadith in Bukhari Muslim that none of you should hold his private part with his right hand whilst he is urinating. And none of you should wipe himself from defecation with his right hand. And none of you should blow into a vessel. طيب. So the hadith is clearly telling us what? Not to use our right hand. And the illa, what's the illa for this? Apart from being clearly mentioned as a prohibition in the hadith, what's the reason for the ruling? Takreeman liyad, like we said, right? Takreeman for the right, honoring the right hand, right? We said for everything which is good, use the right. Everything which is less and not noble, we use the left. طيب. In this hadith, you find that the Prophet ﷺ forbade it. But we are saying it's makruh. How is this the case? Because in the chapter of adab pertaining to mannerisms, the prohibitions are to be taken as being disliked. This is a qaida that many ulama have, as mentioned by Shaykh Uthaymeen rahimahu ta'ala and others, right? So the salaf, the thing that removes the prohibition from being a clear prohibition, bring just makruh, is that it comes under the chapter of mannerisms. That which is under the chapter of mannerisms, except for one or two things, then the prohibitions are considered as makruh. So you may read the hadith like I did many times, but the Prophet is telling us not to do it. Clear prohibition. Yet you, Imam, and authors are telling us that it's makruh. It's because of this. They have a set of rulings which they deduce from looking into the Sharia, that those prohibitions which are under the chapter of mannerisms are to be taken as makruh and not haram. طيب. So how then, the Imam says to us that you cannot hold your private part with your right hand. How then do you clean yourself? How then do you clean yourself? How? Yeah, so you, because the Prophet said not to hold in your right hand once you are urinating, right? So you use your left, but you have to hold
with your left, cleaning your right.
I said this one in front of you. Hold your private part with your left, and the thing you are cleaning with is in your right hand. You hold the private part with the left, and the thing you are cleaning with is in your right hand, as mentioned by Muhammad Muftar al-Shibiti in his explanation for the fiqh. طيب, the Hanbali scholars, they say this prohibition of not touching your private part with your right is in all situations. All situations of touching your private part falls under this prohibition. Why do you think they said that? What can they retaliate for this? They said, anybody know? Guess? It's noble, right? The nobility again, right? That's to do with it. They said, look, here you have a direct need to hold your private part in your right hand, right? When you're urinating, to prevent your urine from going everywhere. It's a direct need. So if the prohibition is pertaining to a direct need, then everything after it is from Bab al-Awla. Everything after that or other than that is Musa. So therefore the prohibition, it applies to all situations. This is the opinion of the Hanbali scholars. Other scholars, they said no, it's only for when you're urinating. Why? Muhammad, لا يمسكن أحدكم ذكره بيمينه وهو يده. What's the opinion of the other scholars? Why? From this part? What were you? In Arabic, what's the I'm asking because he's quite good at grammar, mashallah. The Arabic grammar, what were you? Because this is what will happen. What will happen is the wow of being in a situation, right? So the other scholars, they said, no, it's only for this situation because the wow and the hal is used. In any case, our scholars, the Hanbali scholars, they said, you cannot touch your private part with your right hand, right? What is istinja'uhu wa istijma'uhu biha? Nor can you wash with the right hand after having relieved yourself, nor can you use stones or paper or anything of that nature to clean yourself with the right hand. However, if you are pouring water with the right hand onto your area, then that's well and good. Then he says, what is the qibal al-nayyirain? Or, also it's dislike, is to face the two lights. What does he mean by the two lights? Al-Shams wal-Qamar, the moon and the sun. The moon and the sun. Imam al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala said nothing in this mas'ala is authentic, right? In terms of ahadith. The ahadith are not authentic which pertain to this mas'ala. However, the ta'aleel, there is still a ta'aleel that the Hanbali scholars they use. They say, for example, at night, when you're relieving yourself and you're facing in the direction of the light of the moon, what are you doing? You're exposing your awrah for people to be able to see what you're doing, right? So this is one of the ta'aleelat that can be still used. That you do not face towards the sun or the moon when you are exposing yourself. The Imam says, وَيَحْرُمُ. And it's forbidden, haram. وَيَحْرُمُ إِسْتِقْبَالُ الْقِبْلَ وَاسْتِقْبَالُهَا فِي غَيْرِ الْبُنْيَانِ. And it's not permitted for you to face the Qibla or to have your back towards the Qibla whilst relieving yourself, right? If you are outside of a building. Not allowed for you to face the Qibla or to have your back towards the Qibla when relieving yourself if you are not contained within a building. In Bukhari Muslim, the hadith of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet said, إِذَا أَتَيْتُمُ الْغَائِدِ, if you come to defecate, فَلَا تَسْتَقْبِلُ الْقِبْلَ وَلَا تَسْتَدْبِرُهَا. So do not face the Qibla, nor turn your backs toward it. وَلَا تَشَرِّقُوا أَوْ غَرِّقُوا. But rather, turn to the east or turn to the west. So the narrator of the hadith, Abu Ayyub, he says, فَقَدِمْنَا الشَّام. We went to the lands of Sham. فَوَجَدْنَا مَرَحِيدٌ بُنِيَةَ قِبْلَ الْقِبْلَ. We found bathrooms built facing in the direction of the Qibla. فَنَنْحَرِفُ أَنْهَا وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ. So we should turn away from them and we will seek forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jalla. So it's something which is well understood that you do not face the Qibla in terms of relieving. Some scholars, they allow this to take place in a building, okay? To face the Qibla or to have your back towards the Qibla if you're in a building. Where they get this from? They get this from the hadith of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, who says, رَقِيتُ يَوْمٌ عَلَى بَيْتِ أُخْتِ حَفْصَ. He said, one day I climbed upon the house of my sister Hafsa. فَرَأَيْتُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى حَاجَتِهِ. And I saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم relieving himself. Again, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, we know he was covered, right? His awra was covered. Mustaqbil al-Sham, Mustaqbira al-Ka'bah. Mustaqbil al-Sham. Facing Sham, right? And his back towards the Ka'bah. He was facing the direction of Sham, and his back was towards the Ka'bah. So anyway, there's so many differences of opinions on this, but this hadith allows that in the building you can have your back towards the Qibla, but not your front. In any case, the believer, when he's building his house, he will always try to face the bathroom away from the direction of the Qibla. طيب. وَلُبْثُهُ فَوْقَ حَاجَتِهِ. And to stay naked in the bathroom after having relieved himself. This is also what? What's the ruling of this? Huh? Dislike, right? Dislike, dislike. Why is it dislike? I said one of the reasons, because you're in a place where there could be jinn. You're in a place where there's evil, right? That's why you said the dua, I'll become a khuti bil khabariyah. And also, it's just not a right thing for a person in a normal state of mind to do, to be in that type of situation. So it's something we should be avoided. You don't sit there reading the newspaper, etc. You've done what you need to do and you move on. Also, he says, وَبَوْلُهُ فِي طَرِيقٍ وَظِلٍ نَافِعٍ وَتَحْتَ شَجْرَةٍ عَلَيْهَا ثَمَرَةٍ. It's all the haram, right?
This is the haram section.
This is the haram section. So this is haram, yes.
And the one
preceding as well. What was the first one? To face the Qibla, right?
Yes. The second one is staying longer than needed.
The second haram thing, prohibited thing, is to stay longer than needed. And now we're in. وَبَوْلُهُ فِي طَرِيقٍ. And for the person to urinate in a pathway. وَظِلٍ نَافِعٍ. And under shade, which is used by people. وَتَحْتَ شَجْرَةٍ عَدَيْهَا ثَمَرٍ. Or under a tree which has fruits. Why is it not permitted to urinate or defecate in a pathway? You're going to harm people, right? What about in a place where there's shade? You're going to harm people. What about in a place where there's trees that are bearing fruit? You're going to harm people. Then the fruit that they want to eat is going to fall into these places. The proof of this is in the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said in Sahih Muslim, narrated by Abu Hurairah, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ittaqu ala alayn." Beware and fearful of the two who are cursed. They said, "Man la'alayn ya Rasulullah." Who are the two that are cursed? The Prophet ﷺ said, "Alladhi yattakhalla fi tariq al-nas aw fi dhilli." The one who relieves himself in the pathways of the people or in the places which they take as shade, right? So it's something which we have to avoid. Some of the ulama, they say it's allowed sometimes for you to relieve yourself in places where there are shade and people gather. Why do you think the imam said this? Let everyone have a quick thought. No, come on. No.
Because it's secluded, there's shade there, maybe some people can't see.
But people use it. People use that place. Ascent, barakallahu feek. If it's for enjoying the good and forbidding the evil, if you know that regularly the druggies, they get together and they smoke their drugs and inject themselves in this area, for people to relieve themselves then in that area is well and good, because then those people, the sound of mind, they won't come and use this place anymore. So some of the ulama, they mentioned this ta'leem. He also says which is prohibited. وَيَسْتَجْمِرُهُ. He didn't say which is prohibited. Now he says from the adab, وَيَسْتَجْمِرُهُ ثُمَّ يَسْتَنْجِ بِالْمَا. What he should do is that he should make istijmar, which is to use stones or paper or anything of that nature. And then he should use water. Why? Why should it be first that you should use stones and then water? Why not the other way around? Why not water first, then stones? Water first, then tissue?
You might make the purity spread if you use water first.
Possible. You might make the purity spread. But no. No.
Use less water?
No.
Remove the physical part first.
I said it's very close. This is the point. So you remove the physical najasa with something like a stone or something like tissue of that nature. So your hand is not touching the physical najasa, right? Because when you use water, you have to use your hand also to clean what's left over. So the first of them is you use istijmar from istinja. You use something solid like a stone or paper, then you use water. The second of them is you use water and then something to wipe. But in today's day and age, we have things like the washers, which are very powerful, and so this does most of the job. Okay? And the third is to use istijmar by itself, to use stones by themselves without water. These are the levels of cleanliness. The first of them is to do the stones, then the water. The second of them is to do the water alone. The third of the states is to do the stone alone. طيب. The Imam says, وَيُجْزِئُهُ الْإِسْتِجْمَارُ إِنْ لَمْ يَعْدُوا الْخَارِجُ مَوْضِ الْعَادَةِ. It will suffice him to do istijmar. It will suffice him not to use water, the Imam is saying, to use just the stone or the tissue, if the najasa doesn't go beyond its normal passage, its normal exit. Okay? If the najasa doesn't go beyond the normal exit, then it suffices you only to use istijmar. Why do you think this is? Why is he saying this? If the najasa spreads beyond the normal situation, right, onto the cheeks or wherever else, sorry to be explicit, in this situation, the Imam is saying it's not enough just to use the istijmar, not enough just to use the stones and the papers. Why? Because now it's not istinja anymore. Okay? Now it becomes izalat najasa, the removal of impurities which requires water. Izalat najasa is only done by water, right? ويشترط للاستجمام بأحجار ونحوها أن يكون طاهراً منقياً. And it's imperative conditionally that if you're going to use rocks or paper or anything of that nature to clean yourself, then it has to be pure, طاهر, and it has to be منقي. It has to be pure and it has to be منقي. منقي, this word means نقاء, that has to be cleaning. So for example, you cannot get foil, you cannot get glass or anything of that nature. Why? They're pure. For it is pure, no one's going to look at you and say this is impure. Why can't you use it? Because it's going to spread the najasa. It's not going to clean the najasa, right? Likewise, glass. So it has to be not only pure, but it has to give the effect of niqab. The ulama, they mentioned, what is the dhabit of niqab? Dhabit, we mentioned this word before. Dhabit is... Dhabit is... The thing which regulates, okay? The thing which regulates. So the dhabit for cleanliness here, niqab, they say, is that the physical najasa itself will be removed and only left is traces. That which you only use water for. And the traces are overlooked if you do not have water, okay? But the niqab that has to be there is that the physical amount of the najasa is removed. So the dhabit of the niqab, the dhabit of the regulating of the what is cleanliness required is that the physical amount is removed and the traces are only left which water will be used for. So we're cleaning, right? We're using stones, we're using water or anything which is pure to use. Now the Imam gives an exception, because you may be thinking of a variety of things that you may have to use if you're in an abnormal situation. He says, غَيْرَ عَذْمٍ وَرَوْثٍ وَطَعَّمٍ وَمُحْتَرَمٍ وَمُتَّصَلٍ بِحَيَوَانٍ. He says, what's not allowed for you, the exception, is that you cannot use bones, nor can you use dung, nor can you use food, nor can you use anything which is muhtaram, anything which has status or value, nor can you use that which is connected to an animal like its tail. The Prophet ﷺ in the Tirmidhi, it's narrated that he said, لا تستنجو بالروث ولا بالعظام فإنه زاد إخوانكم من الجن. Don't relieve you, don't clean yourselves after having visited the bathroom with rough. Rough is dung. Is that the right word, dung, right? Rough is dung and not bones either. Because verily they are both food sources for your brothers from the jinn. Right? They're both food sources for your brothers from the jinn. Leftover animal dung, etc. Okay, and the bone after the meat has been taken away, is food for the believers of the jinn. Why can't you use food? Why can't you use food, human food, to relieve yourself? It's a respected thing, very good. If you cannot use the food of the jinn, then in Bab al-Awla, then more so you cannot use the food of human beings. But like you said, it's also something which has value and is respected. The Imam says, we'll end with this inshaAllah. وَيُشْتَرَطُ ثَلَاثُ مَسَحَاتٍ وَمْقِيَةٍ فَأَكْثَرٍ. It's conditional when you clean yourself that you have three wipes which end up with cleanliness or more. Three wipes which end up with cleanliness or more. Right? وَلَوْ بِحَجْرٍ فِي شُعْرٍ. Even if it be that it's one rock or stone that has three sides to it. So it doesn't have to be three stones. It can be a stone which is large enough for you to use three parts of it, three sides of the stone. وَيُسَنْ قَطْعُهُ عَلَى وِتْرٍ. And it's recommended by sunnah for you to stop upon witr. Stop the wipings upon a witr number. In Sahih Muslim, in the hadith of Salman ibn al-Farsi, he said the Prophet ﷺ, نَهَانَا أَن نَسْتَقْبِلَ الْقِبْلَ لِغَائِةٍ أَوْ بَوْءٍ. That the Prophet ﷺ forbade us from facing the qibla if you want to relieve yourself. The beautiful thing about this hadith, they were trying to make fun of Salman ibn al-Farsi. They were trying to make fun of the Muslims. And say, your Prophet even teaches you how to go to the bathroom. What did Salman do, radiallahu anhu? He said, nah, well actually it means this, you know, he started to interpret it in a way that will please the Prophet. He said, no, he stood up clearly and he's told him this hadith. He said, yes, the Prophet told us X, Y, Z. So he said, Nahana Rasulullah and Nastaqbila al-Qibla inviting Allah. The Prophet forbade us from facing the Qibla for defecating or urinating. Oh, and Nastanja bin Yameen, or that we should clean ourselves with our right hands. Or that nastanja bi aqal min thalath masahat. Or that we clean ourselves with less than three wipes. Or that nastanja bil raji aw bil adam. Or that we clean ourselves with dung or with bones. Right? So here it's clearly mentioned what the Imam said, that there has to be three wipes or more if you need it. وَلَوْ بِحَجْرٍ ذِي شُعْرٍ. As we said, even if it be a rock or a stone that needs, that has three sides to it. What if you need to do more than three wipes? What do? You go ahead and do more than three wipes, but...
finish on a rock.
Very good. You try your best to finish on a rock, because in the hadith of Bukhari, مَنْ إِسْتَجْمَرَ فَلْيُوتِ. Whoever makes istijmar, then he should end on a odd number. طيب, we'll stop, inshallah. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ نَبِي مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرٍ. Anything which was correct, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, mistakes and shortcomings.